Meeting of the Library and Community Service Commission is called to order. Commissioner Tafoya, can you please do the Pledge of Allegiance?
Yes. Ready? One, two, and three. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Can you please call roll call?
Commissioner Camacho?
Present.
Commissioner Tafoya?
Present.
Commissioner Martinez? Commissioner Gutierrez Garcia?
Present.
Commissioner Fong?
Present.
Thank you. Now we are going to do the introductions. Director Lundquist?
Sure. Thank you, Chair and members of the Commission. We're always pleased to come before you at your meetings and do introductions for new staff. So I am pleased to introduce Tim Calker. He is our new deputy librarian and will be leading the Library Services Division going forward. And then I'd like to introduce Francis Hebert, who's going to be introducing a couple of other new library staff. Well, one new and one promotion.
Thank you, Kristen. Hello, commissioners. So first, I'd like to highlight Lisbeth Meza, who's been with us for a little while. She was promoted to the position of library technician within the technical services team. And then I'll also like to introduce William Strong as our newest librarian one for adult services. Very happy to have him on the team as well. Thank you.
Welcome.
Welcome and congratulations. Now we have commendations, community educational manager Ernesto.
Good evening, commissioners. Tonight we would like to take the opportunity to recognize some amazing and talented youth from our community. Today we will be awarding the award to our Salinas Youth Poet Laureate from 2024. And this was the candidate who emerged as the winner from the call for projects or call for proposals that we had before the summer. And so we had some great judges selecting and having the tough choice of making our selection for our laureate and our vice laureate. The judges included former laureates, youth laureates, Mahi Saw, VNA Aguirre, as well as director of the Boys and Girls Club, Jose Moran, and our mayor, Mayor Craig, were part of the judging panel. So I would like to call upon our friends from the Salinas Public Library, Nympha McGaw, to be able to present the awards to our 2024 Salinas Youth Poet Laureate, Maya Pop. And so I'm going to turn the floor over for Maya to recite one of her poems for us tonight.
Hi. This poem is titled Confidence. Confidence. It is a shield but does not make you indestructible. It is armor but even armor breaks after taking too many blows. Confidence. Being confident doesn't mean you are perfect but are okay with your imperfections. Confidence. Confidence is trusting yourself and not caring about others. Confidence. Just because you don't care, it doesn't mean it doesn't hurt. Confidence. Being confident is like having guns to your head, those guns pairs of eyes watching you, waiting for you to mess up so they can pull the trigger. Confidence. You can wear a bulletproof vest, but it does nothing because words cut deeper than knives which sting on the same level. Confidence. For the first few blows, you are fine because you have bandages, but over time, the bandages run out. Confidence. The cuts sting and your blood seeps through the bandages, and they got what they wanted. They wanted you to hurt. They wanted you to bleed. Confidence. Because you are confident, it shouldn't hurt you. Confidence. I am confident, not indestructible. I am human, not Superman, but even Superman has his weaknesses. Confidence. I am told being confident is good, but it does not feel like it. Confidence. I am told to mind my business, but why don't people mind theirs? Confidence. It is my will, my life, my look, my choice, so why do you still have a say in it? Confidence. I am confident, not indestructible. I am happy, not perfect. I am me, and you are not. Confidence.
Thank you very much, Maya. And again, congratulations on the award. Maya will be serving for the next 2 years. And so her and our vice laureate, who unfortunately wasn't able to make it, Giselle Alvarado will be the vice laureate. And they'll be working together to hopefully be able to raise the art of poetry and youth engagement in our community for the next 2 years.
Commissioners, if you'd like to come down off the dais, we could certainly take a picture and we can post it to social media and recognize this wonderful youth in our community.
Thank you. Congratulations again. Public comment procedures. If you wish to make a general public comment or comment on a specific agenda item, you are encouraged to attend the Library and Commission of Service Community Service Commission meeting in person. Email public comments received have been distributed to the commissioners and will be entered into the record. Any public comments? Thank you. General public comments. We are now open to public comments on items that are not on the agenda and that are in the City of Salinas subject matter jurisdiction. Comments on agenda items should be held until the items are reached. Now we go to item ID 24-266, the minutes. We have received the minutes from May 8, 2024. Do the commissioners have any comments? Thank you.
A motion to approve the minutes of May 8th.
I'll second.
Can you call for a roll?
Commissioner Camacho?
Yes.
Commissioner Tafoya?
Yes.
Commissioner Gutierrez Garcia?
Yes.
Commissioner Fong?
Yes.
Motion passed.
Thank you. We move to item ID number 24-516, election of commission chair and vice chair. The positions of chair and vice chair of the Library and Community Service Commission are nominated and elected by active commission members to serve 1 year term. I will now ask the commissioners to nominate one member for commissioner chair and another member for commissioner vice chair. each to serve in their respective positions for 1 year. Do I have any nominations?
Yes. Do we do one at a time, or can we do both?
One at a time.
I motion for Victor Tafoya for chair and Albert Fong for vice chair.
Do you accept the nominations?
I do.
Accept nominations?
Yes.
Okay. Now
we have a first by Commissioner Camacho, and Commissioner Fong, did you second that?
Yes.
Okay, now call for the vote.
Can you call roll call, please?
Commissioner Camacho?
Yes.
Commissioner Tafoya?
Yes.
Commissioner Gutierrez-Garcia?
Yes.
Commissioner Fong?
Yes.
Motion passed.
We switch?
Yes.
Okay. I have a lot of stuff.
If I may, I also like to say thank you to Nancy. The year went by fast. When I saw this on the agenda, I was like, wow, it's been a year. I feel like it's always like that, so.
So I received word that we have our Salinas City Youth Poet Laureate, Giselle Alvarado, who just showed up.
Our Vice Laureate for the 2024 Salinas Youth Poet Laureate. We're very delighted to be able to have a colleague with whom our Salinas Poet Laureate will be able to really grow within the position and provide to our community. So I would like to introduce you to Giselle Alvarado, who is our 2024 Salinas Youth Vice Youth Poet Laureate for 2024, and we will have Ninfa present her award.
Okay, one second. If you don't mind, I'm going to set my phone up. My parents weren't able to make it. So like they said, my name is Giselle Alvarado. I'm beyond grateful to be standing here as Vice Laureate. Poetry has been a passion of mine since as long as I can remember. I was writing poetry at like the age of 9, and I never stopped, even though over time, many times it felt like I'd never get anywhere with it, just because poetry always felt underappreciated. It was like one of those things you just learned about in high school. You learn about Edgar Allan Poe, never hear about it ever again. But it just always stuck with me, and I'm glad that even though I felt as it had gone underappreciated, I'm glad I continued writing it because it feels like now a door in my life has been opened where now I get to share my poetry with other people. And I will always make sure that my poetry is up to interpretation because what I want is others to resonate with my words. And I just hope to inspire others, really. And once again, thank you for this opportunity. It truly means so much to me. And I'm gonna read to you both of the poems that I had submitted. The first one is called Threads of Truth. In the mirror of our minds, truth entwine, a single thread in humanity's grand design. Each soul's verse, a unique part of the throng, our personal truths to the wider world belong. For one's depth to the expanse we span, stories resonate, a shared undercurrent began. The hopes we harbor, the fears we confess, together they merge our collective tapestry to address. A single hope's whisper from quiet lips sent can journey afar, its power not spent. Our individual paths, distinctly our own, merge into a narrative together sewn. In life's intricate dance, as we move and swirl, our innermost truths to others we unfurl. For in the gaze we share, a silent pact lies in the bond, our singular act. With courage, we examine what we embrace, holding fast to our truths in the human race. For in the vast expanse where our stories meet, our personal truths make us whole, complete. And here is the other one I wrote. This one is called A Deceptive Alert. To be glorified is not a thing I crave, for it brings with it a burden hard to bear. The weight of expectations like a wave can crush the soul and leave it in despair. For when we're glorified, we're put up high, and every move we make is under scrutiny. The slightest slip can make us fall and die and leave us lost in our own mutiny. To be glorified is not to be free, for we're bound by the image that we show. We're forced to be what others want to see and hide the parts of us that they don't wish to know. So let me be and let me live my life without the burden of being glorified.
We would love to take a picture with you.
I would be honored to. Thank you.
Congratulations.
Thank you. Congrats.
Okay, now we are moving to item number 24-517, titled An Ordinance Amending Chapter 28-14 of the Salinas Municipal Code related to the general regulation governing the use of parks and recreation areas or facilities. Director Lunkels, will you present a report?
Yes, thank you, commissioners. So I want to just give you a little bit of background. Chapter 28 of the Salinas Municipal Code was established in 1956, and it really governs the use of our recreation facilities and our parks. Since that time, the ordinance has been updated occasionally as the need arises, and the most recent one was done in 2009, which spoke specifically to the prohibition of the use of fireworks within the parks. So, in an effort to address concerns that we've had regarding the use of parking lots at various recreation park facilities and or parks, and to address the use of parks for campaign-related activities, staff is recommending two minor changes to this ordinance. And if you, along in your packet, is the actual language in the ordinance with the red line changes for you for review. In addition to these two items, the first one focuses on parking lot use. And I won't go through the entire report, it's pretty straightforward. But we do have situations where in our facilities where we have gates that it becomes a safety and problematic when we aren't able to lock those gates. And it's problematic when we have vehicles that stay in those parking lots past our hours of operation, which I'm sure you all are aware is dawn to dusk. So that change was added as section 28-14N, and it reads, parking lots are open and available for use consistent with the hours of operation of park and recreation facilities. Vehicles remaining in parking lots outside the hours of operation are subject to tow at owner's expense. The next change relates to campaign-related activities and signs. And all non-commercial signage is prohibited on city property to include parks. We did want to make sure that everyone is aware that our parks and some other locations like the front of City Hall are public spaces where a variety of campaign activities can occur there. We just want to reinforce that the signage can't be posted in a park and left there. So that's that change. The specific language that's listed in the ordinance is placement of signs to place temporary non-commercial message signs, including but not limited to campaign signs, in conjunction with a primary or a general election. There are a couple of other minor, not very consequential changes as well that were redlined, and then a number of the last page or so, because we added these two sections, needed to be renumbered. So those are the main changes. That concludes my report. I'm happy to answer any questions that anyone may have. I did want to point out, because there are only four of you here, it does require a vote, a positive vote for all four of you for us to move this forward. And so what I'd be looking for is a motion recommending that the Salinas City Council adopt an ordinance amending Chapter 28-14 of the Salinas Municipal Code related to general regulations governing the use of parks, recreation areas, or facilities. Happy to answer any questions.
Hey, commissioners, do we have any questions or comments starting to my left? Commissioner Fong?
I read through this. I'm fine with everything that's on here.
I was just thinking there's a lot of these rules and regulations. How do we enforce this? I mean, it's out there, and hopefully everyone, you know, will abide by the rules and all that. And I think that's what's happening. But if somebody doesn't follow these rules, What did you do?
So we would take those on a case-by-case basis. We do have a number of these rules that are posted at all of our facilities, specifically the parks. We would, in terms of a parking, no parking after hours and the vehicles being subject to tow, we will need to develop signage that will be placed in all of those locations. And the way the city handles towing is there's interaction with the police department, who would then call out a tow company to address that. My hope is with signage that speaks to vehicles being towed at the owner's expense, that that would be helpful and people would adhere to those rules. But it is a bit of an honor system with, along with all of our rules, that we hope residents will follow.
Thank you.
Commissioner Gutierrez, any comments or questions?
The same with the parking lots. Are they just going to tow their cars away, or are they going to get any warning, a ticket, before the actual car being towed?
So what we're hopeful with this action will give us another tool in our tool belt to be able to ensure that parking lots where it's critical that they get closed due to safety reasons, that we have that tool in our toolbox. The reality is, if it's an ongoing issue, there likely will not be notification but for the sign that's up at the park that lets residents know if they stay past dusk, their vehicle will be subject to tow.
Thank you. I know that's in around some parks, there is a lack of parking spaces. So that's why some people park inside the parking lot of the park. So that's why I was thinking of those people. Thank you.
Commissioner Camacho, any questions or comments?
Yes, a couple of questions regarding the parking again, and sort of on that same concern. This is addressing parking at recreation and park facilities, right? But we oversee also libraries, and there's like library parking also to take into consideration. Does this apply also to that? And the reason I ask is for the overflow parking from nearby residences, like at Cesar Chavez, for example, that gets filled up real quick. And so how do we address that?
So a couple of things. This does specifically address parks and recreation facilities. We have been talking to staff about the issues at Cesar Chavez, and we'll be working on a mechanism to address that as well. One of the things that I think will be critical is to have gates installed at that parking lot that will help us be able to move forward something similar to this so that we can control that lot.
Okay. It just seems, I almost feel like we could tackle a lot of these issues with if we look at, you know, to the question on how do we make sure people are abiding by these ordinances? I mean, I see some things on here regarding like bathrooms or bounce houses and safety equipment at the skate park. I mean, oftentimes I go to the skate park and no one's wearing a helmet, right? But it's one of the things listed on here. So would it be beneficial to kind of look at all of these and ensure that with one motion we can just update it to 2024 as opposed to nitpicking certain ones?
So Anna and I spoke about potentially making some other changes, but the question you bring up about enforcement is a real concern. We do not have park enforcement officers. We don't have park rangers who can cite. So things like this are handled on a case-by-case basis and really set as guidelines for our residents to utilize our facilities effectively. So I did not want to make significant changes and update everything for that reason. Use of those facilities are really at the honor of our residents. And so my hope is that they will abide by rules. And if we have a problem, we will address them as they come.
Okay. And then in regards to signage for campaigns, I'm in agreement with that. Does that apply also for special events? So if there is a special event at a park for a candidate running for a seat, but you said signs left behind, does it apply to signs during the event or also?
No, we're really focusing on a situation where people put up yard signs along a frontage of a park and leave them there as advertisement for a campaign. That's not an appropriate use of the facilities.
Right. Okay. I think those were the only questions. Is there, if I wanted a review of the other items on this, in section 2814, for possible changes, is that a motion I would need to make to address some of changes that, see if we could make changes to it or amendments or revisions?
You can certainly, you know, ask staff to go back and take a look at this, and we could certainly do a deeper dive. But again, I would caution the commission that making significant changes that require enforcement could be problematic.
Okay. Makes sense. No more questions.
Perfect, thank you. Now, looking at the staff report, there's a couple of questions or confirmations that I'm looking for. So in reading it, it appears that this ordinance is updated on as issues emerge. Is that correct?
Yes, you are correct.
So it appears that there are 11 recreational park facilities that have a parking lot. Out of those 11 parking lots, 7 are located near park facilities. And out of the 7 parking lots, there are 4 with gated parks that include El Dorado Park, McKinnon Park, Montebella Park, and Sherwood Park. Is that correct?
Yes, you are correct.
So essentially, this potential change would only affect 4 parking lots. Is that correct?
From the park locations, correct. We have had in the past, prior to the demolition of Hebron, there were gates at that parking lot, and so it would, there are plans for gates to go back in at that parking lot, and so we would, this change would also impact that facility. But right now, we only have 4 parks.
In reading that new section, it states vehicles remaining in parking lots outside of the hours of operations are subject to towing at the owner's expense. Now, looking through the whole entire document, I did not see any stated hours of operations, nor did I find the words dawn to dusk. And I know that other municipalities nearby, for example, the city of Gilroy, has specific hours written in their municipal code. Is there a reason why we don't specifically state those hours of operations in our municipal code?
That's a good question. I do know that, and we're going to talk about another, we have another item where we talk about the commission has some leeway to set specific rules. And it could have been that many, many years ago, the commission established the dawn to dusk situation. And dawn to dusk is posted at our parks. So it is posted that time frame.
I think in order to have an ordinance that we could enforce, I think that should be included somewhere here so people are aware of the rules and regulations and not just posted outside the parks themselves.
That's something you could certainly do as part of a motion to accept these changes and include the specification of the dawn to dusk timeframe.
So, I understand some of the pros to gating the parking lots. It enhances security, reduces litter and vandalism, and it can possibly deter illegal activities. I strongly recommend that city staff explore the feasibility of incorporating gated parking lots in other parks. One park that comes to mind is Natividad Creek Park, or any park that is appropriate that is possible to do this. Now, so I can understand better how this process would occur. I have a question, a hypothetical question. So let's say I visit the Montebella Community Park in Salinas. I park my car in the lot while I enjoy some time in the playground. I end up losing track of time, and by the time that I get to my car, it's well past hours and the gates are already closed. What happens in this situation? Can you walk me through the process city staff would take regarding my car being left in the parking lot after hours?
So, two things. We have a janitorial service crew who comes and cleans the restrooms and is responsible for locking the gates. My hope is if residents were playing in the park and they saw this company come through to start cleaning the restrooms and looking at the gate, that they would immediately respond and move their vehicle. If not, and we just close the gate without requesting the vehicle to be towed, it would be left in the park overnight. I suspect many residents, if that happened to them, they would find their own way out of the park, which could ultimately cause some damage to the facility.
So looking through the whole entire document, I decided to explore, look at some other language, and I have some other potential updates apart from that brand new section. For example, on the littering section, I think that it should also include prohibit to discard or discharge any solid or liquid substance, pollutants, or contaminants into any fountain, pool, lake, stream, or similar waters, or into any drain that discharges into such waters within the park. This includes near creeks and waterways where improper disposal can severely harm aquatic life, disrupt ecosystem, and pollute the water. This comes to mind because Natividad Creek Park is situated near a creek. And I think we have to acknowledge that and deter littering within our creeks. As far as harming of birds or animal life, I have some comments there. I think this should include the feeding or disturbing of wildlife. I think that could lead to dependency on human-provided food and may cause harm to their health. The National Park Service advises against feeding wildlife to maintain the animal's natural behavior and ecosystem. As far as soliciting goes, I was not aware that it was actually prohibited to solicit. I know that there are some faith organization members that like to do their soliciting at parks, and given this text here section, I think we should either exempt them from the soliciting or enforce actual soliciting of their activities.
And I think if I spoke to the city attorney specifically to that item, that would be considered freedom of speech and so may not be applicable to this section. But that's certainly something we could look into.
Got it. So my last comments on this is that if this goes through and gets adopted by the city, Salinas City Council, I think there has to be an educational component to this. It's not just enough writing this and enforcing it. I think we need to either make a community event in which we inform residents of this new update, launch some sort of campaign with our local news production organizations and informing them of this update. I was looking at some of the costs that someone may incur if something like this, if they have to go through a towing service, this could easily cost $150 to $500. Pretty substantial amount, in my opinion. And other than that, I have no additional comments.
Chair, if we could, I guess maybe go back to Commissioner Camacho. I don't know. I mean, we talked a little bit about we could take a deeper dive. I don't know if she has some specific suggestions at this point. If we're going to make other modifications, this would be the time to hear from all commissioners on any additions that they would like to see.
Yeah, I think there's a couple of things, like some of the ones that Chair Tafoya have highlighted that could be amended, and we can just like update. I feel like these two on an as-needed basis, if we're gonna do the effort, I think we need to be a little more deliberate with the language for the parking. I think there needs to be some community education, and I also would like to see like what is the, a tow truck doesn't come right when you call it. So like if we are using any outside services to clean the bathrooms and they're calling who's calling the tow truck, and if they're gonna have to wait an hour, 2 hours, how is a tow truck company gonna get access to the bar? Like I just feel like we need a little more information to ensure that if we are gonna enforce something like this, and that's the reason why we're pushing it forward, that we kind of look at different scenarios and how it's going to impact communities. Most importantly, the residents near these four parks that are going to be immediately affected. So I don't know if I'm clear on what I want to do, but I would say like the motion would be to hold off and regroup with staff. I don't know if we're needed in that regrouping or if we make a list.
So the commission can certainly table an item. I will say that part of the need for this change is being responsive to a neighborhood,
right,
and their desires to have more tools for us to be able to ensure that we can lock the gate at their location. And so I have communicated to them that this was coming to the commission tonight. That certainly, if it is tabled, will delay our ability to take any action. So I just put that forward to the commission.
And I understand that, and I feel like if we're gonna establish or amend something that affects the whole entire city based on one neighborhood, we need to also be fair to the entire city, because it's not just one park. We represent all of Salinas, and that's where the impact is. And I hope they understand that too. And I wish they would be here also to express that concern.
So if the commission wishes, you could certainly make a motion and second and vote to table this item to next month. And I would ask at that point that any recommendations that you have, those get emailed to me so that we can update this document with additional track changes. And staff, we can do our due diligence to bring back some additional information about process and how we would educate or how we would handle these things at the next meeting.
Is there a time frame you would want those responses or suggestions, like from this meeting till next month, to give you appropriate time to review?
Yeah, I mean, if you can get them to me in a week, it sounds like at least two members of the commission have given a lot of thought to that and may have readily available information. So if that's doable for the rest of the commission, is a week sufficient to provide your additional comments? Okay. We'll bring this back in October.
Could I say something? I'm hearing what you guys are saying, but I think the city needs to establish some guidelines as the parks. And I was at Hartnell about a week ago, and they ticket cars. But because it was the beginning of school year, they gave a leniency where they not ticket for 2 weeks. But I think maybe there's this period that you have the posting that they can get their cars towed, and maybe they can get warnings and not start towing the cars away right away. I'm in the Bay Area, and I see people's cars towed away. It's like $750 right, or something like that. So it could be very expensive. And Commissioner Trefoya was mentioning about the time. I think, does the city have already where the parks are open like 30 minutes after dawn and closing, you have to leave 30 minutes before dusk? The reason is because the season changed, and during the summer we could stay there a long time, but wintertime the hours are short, so you can't really post hours and time, so you have to just depend on Mother Nature, the sun,
correct,
and the weather. I mean, I know our parks, a lot of times when the weather's real bad, there'll be signs, peligro, you know, because the trees might fall and hurt somebody, so.
Correct.
I mean, we have to just look at that. And
yeah.
No, maybe put that kind of wording in there. And
yeah, dawn to dusk, I mean, it's subjective. And so with this park specifically, you know, if we have contracted services that come in at a set time, are they coming in within that time frame also?
Yeah.
Because sometimes dusk is 9 p.m., right?
Yeah.
And so if that agency, or if it's our own staff, if they're coming in at 8:30 to lock the gates, then we don't have that discrepancy. But if that changes.
Yeah, recently recently the bathroom situations have been really good. It stayed open late. But in the past, sometimes they close it at 4:30 because maybe that person needs to do that and move on or something. But okay. A lot of people didn't like that. They needed to use the restroom and stuff. And I see a lot of people just stopping by the parks to use the restroom and just drive off because it is public restroom, so it's convenient for them.
So I will say restrooms are closed on a rotation, right? We have one crew that goes to each location and cleans them and closes them. Given some of our challenges at Montebella, we have instructed our janitorial service company to come at a later date, at a later time. And so they're usually, and it fluctuates through the year, they usually are coming right now about 8:30 in the evening, which is past really what dusk is. And so ideally, if residents have moved their vehicles, they could lock the gate and have no impact to residents who are parking at the location.
So I will motion to table this item to next month with the commission to be tasked to send over any recommendations within a week for the office to have enough, for the staff to have enough time for review, for any additional amendments or revisions, suggestions, et cetera.
And I'll second the motion to table.
Devin, call for the roll.
Commissioner Camacho?
Yes.
Commissioner Tafoya?
Yes.
Commissioner Gutierrez-Garcia?
Yes.
Commissioner Fong?
Yes.
Motion passed.
Great. Moving on to agenda item ID 24-518, rules for use of artificial turf fields. Director Lundquist, will you present the report?
Yes, thank you. So we're really excited about the addition of an artificial turf soccer field at Cesar Chavez Park. This is the first of its kind for our jurisdiction, but we are anticipating other locations to come online with multi-use courts to include a multi-use court at the Hebron Family Center, as well as at El Gavilan Tot Lot. And I believe, which I didn't include in my report, but I also believe Ensign Community Park has a multi-use facility. And so it's a best practice to establish rules. Having artificial turf is different than your regular seed turf. And so we're here before you this evening to get your feedback around establishing a set of rules or things that are prohibited when residents use those facilities. And so what we are looking at are the items that are prohibitive, which are identified in your report, is muddy footwear, spikes or metal cleats, glass bottles or containers, food, chewing gum or drinks, water is okay, smoking and open flames, golfing, vehicles, bicycles, scooters, chairs, tents, canopies, gazebos, or flags with spikes, chalk or field paint, and light generators or amplified sound without proper permitting. Section 28-13 provides that the commission may prescribe and is hereby authorized to prescribe rules and regulations in addition to other items listed in the ordinances and to set those rules. And so that's what we're here before you this evening. It's important to establish these rules because this investment is nearly $1 million and we want to make sure that this turf lives on for as long as possible. So the recommendation before you this evening is a motion recommending the implementation of rules for use of artificial turf fields within the City of Salinas Park system. That concludes my report, and I'm happy to answer any questions.
Any comments or questions from commissioners? Starting to my right, Commissioner Camacho.
Thank you. On the note on enforcement for these, when I look at like Cesar Chavez Park and like the big field, oftentimes if even the City League, say, uses that park, like we do at the Complex Center, we oftentimes divide the field into smaller fields, in which case there's parents up and down the restructured field with chairs, for example. And that's one of the things on here. Or the teams themselves might have a canopy to shelter the kids. How would that be enforced?
So we have park staff that are out and about 7 days a week. And so they would go upon educating residents of, you know, that these items are not allowed. We will have a sign that's posted there. Ultimately, if it's something that is a regular occurrence, we would likely send staff out to have conversations. Keep in mind that on the perimeter of the soccer field itself, the artificial turf, there is normal seed turf, and chairs could be placed there, just not on the artificial turf field. We're very familiar with breaking up, you know, a field into smaller locations for practices. That's certainly something that could be done. It does have regular markings for the size of the facility that it is, but that wouldn't prohibit anybody from going out there and having a practice and having a couple of, you know, two different small youth teams practicing.
Is it possible to recommend that the signage include pictures, not just the rule? Like, you know, if we have like signage with the rules, no spikes, have like pictures or icons to kind of.
Sure, we can certainly explore that.
Yeah. Okay, that would be my only recommendation. Thank you.
Okay, Commissioner Gutierrez.
I have a question. Is the turf, I haven't been to that park yet. Is the turf just inside the frame of the field, or does it have any extra on the side?
So the soccer field itself is out of artificial turf, which is a rubberized material. On the exterior, there is regular turf, grass, if you will, on the perimeter of the facility.
Okay, so it doesn't extend outside the actual field?
Correct.
Okay, thank you.
Commissioner Fong?
I'm okay with this, and afterwards I could make a recommendation to or a motion to pass this. But I'm looking at a lot of these things. It's not that we can't change things later if a problem comes up. Just bring it up to the Parks and Library Commission and deal with the problem, because you can't deal with everything. We don't know if there's other things that could come up And if an issue come up, just bring it up and deal with it. So I'm okay to propose a motion.
Thank you. So for me, I've seen on the news that the installation of the artificial turf has been a contentious topic in cities in the Bay Area. Have we received any opposition letters or any feedback against using artificial turf here in Salinas?
Not that I'm aware of. This was a grant that the Public Works Department received back in 2017-ish, around there. And so there was outreach to our various soccer leagues at that time, especially when we needed to adjust the size of the field due to the costs that had come in for that, you know, actual project. And so we had to make some adjustments. So I have not heard opposition. Certainly there will be some education, because we all know that Cesar Chavez Park has been used in the past for a number of special events. This area will no longer be able to be used for special events. But that said, there is the other half of the park that's on the Hebron and Circle Drive side that has been used for other special events. And so, you know, that's the only, I guess, concern. I've never heard opposition, but that's the concern that has been raised before.
Thank you. Is it cost effective to be installing the artificial turf compared to grass?
I will tell you it, where I think we see savings. I'm not exactly sure what that square footage of actual turf would cost. I do believe there may be some higher costs up front for artificial turf. However, when you look at the longevity and what it allows is for that space to be used on a regular basis. You may recall before the Salinas Regional Soccer Complex took over our soccer fields at Constitution, the heavy use caused damage to those turf fields. And every year, and they still do this, they have to shut down the fields to repair and do a lot of maintenance. So what this allows is for residents to use it year round. There is maintenance involved, and it's something new for our team. But that's, I think, where you get the benefit of artificial turf, is the ability to use it without damaging and having dry spots and open spots where the regular lawn gets worn out.
Great, thank you. Is there any motion to recommend that the City of Salinas Council adopt an ordinance amending Chapter 5? Recommend the implementation of rules for use of artificial turf fields within the City of Salinas Park System.
I motioned.
Is there a second?
I second.
Devin, can you please call for the roll?
Commissioner Camacho?
Yes.
Commissioner Tafoya?
Yes.
Commissioner Gutierrez-Casilla?
Yes.
Commissioner Fong?
Yes.
Motion passed.
Okay, moving on to commissioners' reports. Starting to my left, Commissioner Fong, any reports?
Just one item, and I already had a little discussion with Commissioner Tafoya on this. Can we get our commission to encourage the council people for District 4 and 6 to fill in the vacancy, because it makes it hard for Devin to have a quorum for us when we have meetings, and you got to get 4 out of 5. It's kind of difficult at times. So I don't know what the process is, whether the commission could just fill that position, or you need to talk to the council people. I'm sure you do.
Yeah, we work through the city clerk's office. They are aware of our attendance records. They receive regular reports from us, but we will certainly ask that they follow up with the council members.
Thank you very much. And with the elections coming, things might get switched and rattled around, changed. So we'll see where that goes.
Commissioner Gutierrez, any report?
I just want to remind everybody of the all the tragedies that have been happening, and also give thanks to all the people that keep us safe in all these processes. I have been getting a lot of emails through the school district of my child, and they have a lot of help, psychological or just being there for each other. So I think we should be united and just be blessed for what we have, and just pray for peace. Yes, and also right now they're cleaning up the park, the Santa Rita Park, and that it was overgrown inside the creek. So that's great because we're going into the winter pretty soon, and the rain, we don't know when it's gonna come by, but that creek gets full very quickly. So that's great because we don't want an overflow. And that's it for my report. Thank you.
Thank you. Commissioner Camacho, any report?
Yes, one, I want to say thank you to the neighborhood team who did the District 2 cleanup at Closter Park like a couple weeks ago. We were helping some residents up and down Tout Street, just kind of help them clean up some of our elderly neighbors. And it was great to see the line I wasn't so great waiting, but it was great to see the line because it is such a valuable resource for the community. With that said, I understand that we've switched the process of communicating these events. It used to be that we would put them on our social media and I feel like it got greater visibility, but of course we have a capacity. And now my understanding is we're doing like door hangers and mailers. I have family that lives in District 2 that was not aware of this event. And so I just maybe get clarification on what radius around that park, since we tend to use the same locations. I want to see that we're sending the message out to not just like the same radius around the park.
So each council member identifies where they want to have mailers sent within that district. They are doing door hangers and some, face-to-face outreach in the neighborhood near those locations, but the mailer doesn't always go to the radius right around the particular location of the cleanup. And we work with the council members. They generally will move their area for mailers around, and we did 500 mailers.
Okay, good. And I do see that we're always at capacity, so that's good. Because the events are held, basically there's one district cleanup a year, right? So before that district gets another opportunity, or the residents in that district get another opportunity, someone living in that district, if it's divided they might not get an opportunity then or a notification for a couple of years then. So is there a way that we can possibly revisit the process to ensure that the district residents are using maybe like doing an ID card that shows their address to ensure that people outside of the district are not utilizing, or people might, I understand that there's concerns that people outside the district or from different towns were coming and utilizing those services. And so like to ensure that it's district specific, maybe open it up, but have certain restrictions on who uses it. Is that a possibility?
We can certainly explore how we track those things. And maybe possibly, set requirements that people have to show documentation. The challenge still becomes that capacity. And so that basic capacity, and I may ask Anna for help, I think it's somewhere around 150, roughly, to 200 vehicles. And so you may recall we didn't necessarily have capacity issues prior to the pandemic, but following the pandemic, we have seen that where you've had upwards of 200 plus cars, and then we aren't able to get them through the line fast enough through that time period. And so we have some restrictions with in relation to our partner, who is Republic Service. And so that's where that's at. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if you have anything else you want to add.
Yeah, and typically once a year, Republic will do a citywide cleanup, and they mail out every single residence in town. And they also have other resources that residents can utilize. So you'll have a free bulky cleanup a year. Or if you forgot to take your trash out, you can call them and schedule a pickup. So there are other opportunities for residents to get rid of, you know, the bulky items, but they do host one big citywide cleanup.
Thank you. Yeah, I'm thinking like if even if we have like first come, first serve up to 150, people know, maybe like a ticket system. I know people wait hours before they get up to the front sometimes. Wow. And so it's, you know, even if I'm in the district, I got there at 9, I waited about an hour before I got to the front. And so if that was the buildup, then, you know, you have people waiting kind of. I'm always looking at the clock like, oh, it's almost noon. That's the cutoff. But it could actually be before then if you've reached that capacity, right?
Well, they usually, if there's a line at 11:59, they usually will stop the line at the end of that, where, you know, that last vehicle, and they will allow a few more to go through. So we're not necessarily
cutting off
at 11:30 to make sure we're done at noon. Mm-hmm. But I will tell you, it has become problematic when, even if we were to say, okay, the first 150, if you all of a sudden have 300 cars in line,
yeah,
it is problematic letting somebody know, sorry, you're the 150th, or you're the, you know, 180th vehicle. I'm sorry, we're not taking you. So anyways, but we can certainly look at how we might improve how we oversee the cleanups.
Yeah. And the communication aspect for the residents. But it was a great event, and I got to throw away stuff, so that was great. The other kudos is for the Burke Street cleanup that happened last weekend. I actually didn't get a chance to participate, but I drove by and I saw a whole bunch of people. So that was really, really neat to see. We also stopped by briefly for the movie at the park. That was great, one of our favorite movies, and it looked like it was well attended, so kudos to the team for putting that on. And I think that is all I have. Thank you.
Fantastic, thank you. For me, I just have a couple of updates. Well, tomorrow there is a deadline for the neighborhood beautification grant, if you're looking to submit an application. As Commissioner Fong mentioned, we do have two vacancies in this commission, and my recommendation, I would strongly recommend that staff announce the vacancies on social media, if possible, to fill those out. Recently, I read my new book, The Art of Power by Nancy Pelosi. Fantastic read. That reminds me that everybody should pass by your libraries and pick up a book and expand your knowledge on whatever you'd like. So, as I had mentioned before in a prior committee meeting, I asked that upon the installation of a new deputy librarian, that staff revisit the plan to expand library hours. That's something that's near and dear and very important to me. So can we get some sort of update or some sort of plan to implement the expansion of the hours, library hours?
So I think we presented many months to you ago a plan to expand hours. Now that Tim is with us, we certainly will revisit that. It will take some time because we have to work with employee groups and other things to implement those kinds of changes. But we are, and Tim and I had already talked about, that's one of our big projects, is to look how we can expand our hours.
Thank you. And my last comment today is just, I want to acknowledge that today is September 11. So we pause to remember and honor those who've lost their lives, the heroes who responded, and the resilience of the communities united in the face of tragedy. Thank you. Hey, this meeting, Director Lundquist, do you have a report for us?
Yeah. Quickly, I have two items. First, many of you may be aware, Jose Ariola, who was our community safety administrator, has moved on and was promoted to the assistant to the city manager. And so he moved over to the city manager's office the beginning of August, so it's been about a month. I did want to take this opportunity to thank him for his dedication and all that he did to help push forward a variety of LCS initiatives and projects. So I just wanted to publicly acknowledge that. The second thing, we are so excited. Please mark your calendars. September 28th, 11 a.m., we will be holding a groundbreaking ceremony for the new Hebron Family Center building. This is a long time coming. We are hopeful to begin construction in October. And as we've mentioned to you in the past, we do have a tight time frame, and our agreement with the state, due to all of the funding that they provided, is that that facility is open to the public by December 2025. So it will be a fast-paced build, but we're so excited to finally be at this place. And Anna and I will make sure to give regular updates through the through the project to make sure that you're aware of where we're at in that process. That concludes my report.
Could you give us that date and time again?
Yes, Saturday, September 28th at 11 a.m. We will have lots of festivities after the ribbon cutting. We're going to be hosting our annual Hebron Harvest Festival as well. So there'll be lots of activities, fun, food, just a great celebration for the neighborhood.
Fantastic. I am excited for that event, and I will be attending.
Yeah, we have a dunk tank for you.
Oh, wow.
All righty. I am now adjourning this meeting at 7:12.